Hey, thanks for having me tonight. How's everybody doing? Don't answer all at once. All right, why did the IRS audit the chiropractor? He owed back taxes. My friend Jimmy just became certified public accountant. That's right. All I can say is that his days are numbered. Okay, is this mic working? So I bought solar panels for my house, hoping they'd be free because of the tax breaks. I mean, they are on the house, right?
You suck.
Okay, I'm an atheist now because my old church got indicted by the IRS. It turns out they were displaying false prophets. Okay. Unless you are a mathematician or an accountant, likely you've never heard of Fra Luca Bartolomeo di Pacioli. Pacioli was an important person, not just in mathematics, but also in accounting and in magic. He was also important to Leonardo da Vinci, the genius overachiever we all know and love. At one point in his life, da Vinci and Pacioli used to be roommates and close friends. Pacioli was born around 1447 in the Tuscan area of Italy in the city called Sansepolcro. Even though his father was still alive, he lived with a family named Bifolci. Growing up, he received an abaco education, which means his focus was on mathematics. In addition to his traditional education, he also studied at the studio of the artist and mathematician Piero della Francesca. Pacioli completely admired della Francesca, and he learned a great deal, not only as a mathematician, but also as an artist, hence geometer. In 1464, Pacioli moved to Venice, Italy, and tutored three boys who were the sons of a wealthy merchant by the name of Antonio Rhombicuboctahedron. While tutoring in Venice, Pacioli attended secondary school to continue his math studies while working as a teacher, a tutor, and a business manager for Rhombicuboctahedron. During this time in Venice, he began to write his first book, which included some of the material he used while tutoring. When he published this work, he dedicated it to Rhombicuboctahedron's sons. However, this work did not survive. After tutoring for Rhombicuboctahedron, Pacioli traveled to Rome and lived with the brilliant polymath Leone Battista Alberti, who at that time was working for the Catholic Church. While living with Alberti, Pacioli became interested in theology, joined the Franciscan order, and became a friar, hence the title Fra. As a friar, he traveled from town to town as he taught mathematics at various universities. He taught at the University of Perugia between 1477 and 1480. While in Perugia, he wrote Tractatus Mathematicus ad Discipulos Perusinus, which means a mathematical treatise for the students of Perugia. It was a 600-page textbook dedicated to his students at the University of Perugia. This text was one of his first works that emphasized his skills as an accountant and bookkeeper and highlighted his ability to teach the values of accounting. It held 16 accounting-related sections, including bartering, exchange rates, and calculating profits. It also included algebra. However, portions of this subject are missing from the extant manuscript. After his 3 years in Perugia, Italy, he traveled to Zadar, which is across the Adriatic Sea in Croatia, which at that time in the 15th century, Croatia was still part of the Venetian Empire. So, while in Zadar, he authored another book on mathematics. However, this book didn't survive. So, of the three books that survived on arithmetic, the only one that survived was Tractatus. After his time in Zadar, he traveled to Naples, Rome, and Venice, where he taught at the universities. While in Venice in 1494, he published his infamous work, Summa de Arithmetica Geometria e Proportionalita, which means a summary of arithmetic, geometry, and proportionality. He had made quite a name for himself. He became the subject of a famous painting controversially attributed to the Venetian artist Jacopo de Barbari. From 1496 to 1499, he taught in Milan, where he held the chair of mathematics. It was during this time in Milan that he met Leonardo da Vinci. Then, in 1499, he and da Vinci traveled to Florence, where they lived together until Pacioli assumed a teaching position in 1508 in Venice. While living with da Vinci, he also wrote another work called De Divina Proportione, which means of divine proportions. This work also included the first image of a rhombicuboctahedron illustrated by da Vinci, who also illustrated the entire book. A rhombicuboctahedron is a solid with 26 faces. So imagine a cube, which is a solid with 6 square faces. Now imagine a solid with 26 faces that include 6 squares, 8 triangles, and 12 rectangles. It has 24 identical vertices that connect, where at each vertex is 1 triangle, 1 square, and 2 rectangles. Also, these rectangles can be also squares depending on the shape of the rhombicuboctahedron and also depending on the math. What is also remarkable about the De Divina Proportione is that it provides a beautiful illustration of the alphabet and how it should be proportioned. So when Pacioli moved to Venice in 1508, he published his work De Viribus Quantitatis, which means on the strength of quantity. It was a treatise on math and magic, referred to as the foundation of modern magic and numerical puzzles. It contained chapters on math, math puzzles, and math tricks. This was another groundbreaking work that provided the first directions on how to do card tricks. As a side note, for a neat card trick, check out my last show of 2021 called Holiday Puzzle. There's a really cool card trick in that one too. So this work, De Viribus Quantitatis, provided directions on how to juggle, how to make coins dance, and how to eat fire. This friar took fire to a whole new level. After his time in Venice, around the age of 61, he traveled back to Sansepolcro and lived out his life. He passed away around the age of 70 on June 19, 1517. The Summa is his most prominent work. It became a prominent textbook in the schools of North Italy because, for the first time, it covered algebra using the language of Northern Italy. As an aside, and I learned this while studying Italian, across Italy, the vernacular was specific to each region. As a result, during the 15th through the 18th centuries, when they were transitioning from Latin to Italian, the Italian language was not cohesive across the country. It wasn't until the 19th and 20th centuries that the dialects began to decline and standard Italian became prominent across Italy.
Before I go into the accusations of Pacioli's plagiarism, first, a message from today's sponsor.
Today's show is being brought to you by Lock Paper Scissors. If you've never heard of them, I highly recommend them. They make escape rooms, not just for kids, but also for adults, date night, corporate team building events, family gatherings, kids parties, you name it, they make these really cool escape rooms. But they also have classroom material. They sent me the history box kit, which came with the Lost Mummy escape room, which was a lot of fun. I checked it out. Then they also have Adventure Egypt math sheets, which are fantastic. They are for grades 3 through 6 or 7. They teach the importance of PEMDAs. Oh, and this was unexpected. Even though I got a history box kit for the classroom, I also got some really cool stuff to use for date night, like treasure maps for, like, you know, hiding the TV remote when my husband needs to find it. Or a card game called Skulls, which is a lot of fun. My husband and I played it, and of course he won. So I highly recommend Lock Paper Scissors. You can find them at lockpaperscissors.co. I'll also put the link in my description. I highly recommend that you check them out. They're awesome. For my math history buffs, there were rumblings that Pacioli plagiarized others' works, specifically with his two works, the Summa and the Tractatus Mathematicus. Some math historians note that he copied verbatim from other works to write his math texts, and though some science historians may consider that to be plagiarism, others refer to it as appropriation. Dr. Albrecht Heefer, a professor of philosophy at Ghent University, in his 2009 paper titled Algebraic Partitioning Problems from Luca Pacioli's Perugia Manuscript, notes that Pacioli's application and style of argumentation shows an evolution from his older work, Tractatus, to his later work, Summa. Additionally, Heeffer notes that it is evident that Pacioli's 20 years of teaching math across Italy and Croatia influenced his pedagogy and writing style, since we cannot fully immerse ourselves into the 15th century to understand what Pacioli was presenting in his works, it is essential to note that we must look at the existing manuscripts to understand whether or not he plagiarized others' works. Additionally, we have to look at the style of his writing. And for Summa, Heefer notes that Pacioli introduces a new style of argumentative reasoning which was absent from abacus algebra. For example, referencing my own research, if we evaluate the commentaries written by Hypatia of Alexandria in the 4th century, she also pulled material from Euclid's Elements and the Almagest. However, these were commentaries, and the one element that defines them as Hypatia's work is that she provided a different pedagogy, style, and argumentative reasoning. Even though the equations are the same, the delivery and the explanations are different. Hi, Wesley. This is how we can define the difference between plagiarism and appropriation. So, that's Wesley Crusher, by the way. So, his work was one of the first works that outlined a set of tools for accountants and bookkeepers. This textbook provided instructions on how to complete accounting ledgers. It described the importance of outlining assets, capital, expenses, receivables, inventories, and liabilities. Bye, Wesley. It showed how to balance a ledger and conducted year-end entries. And he also impressed the importance of the ricordanze, which means remembrances. This work was similar to a managerial to-do list and included what he called a list of promises, obligations, and conditional agreements. Furthermore, and most notable, this work was the first math textbook to describe the process of double-entry bookkeeping. This procedure became the standard for merchants across Italy. Ah, accounting fun! This method requires that you record your business transactions twice. The first entry is recorded as a debit, the second entry is recorded as a credit, and at the end of the day, the accountant could compare the values to ensure that the sum of the debts equals the sum of the credits. It was a whole new process for the world of accounting. But what is most notable in the Summa is that Pacioli inadvertently challenged the math world by proclaiming that there is no way to solve a cubic equation, much like there is no way to square the circle. The story on squaring the circle is in my January show called Pseudo-Mathematics. Gotta check that one out. This concept of not being able to solve a cubic equation came from when he worked with Da Vinci, Leonardo da Vinci, who showed that one cannot obtain Euclidean irrationals of the square root of the sum of A plus the square root of B, plus the square root of B, I can get that out, when working with the roots of the cubic equation x cubed plus 2x squared plus 10x equals 20. And so, finally, I begin the multi-part story by concluding with this story and Pacioli's final statement in his book Summa de Arithmetica, where he concluded that the means for solving cubic equations by the art of algebra are not yet given, just as the means for squaring the circle are not yet given, unquote. In other words, he declared that it is an impossible problem to solve. Well, This very mathematical statement roused the 16th century competitive math nerds in ways unimaginable. Seriously, it was unimaginable. Stay tuned for my next show on the competitive world of mathematics. Until next time, carpe diem.
I wish I could tell you that the funding of this video has been brought to you through the generous donations of my patrons at Patreon, but I gotta be honest, I have just a few patrons, and I would love to have you come on board, because I can't work for free. I mean, I could go back to the entertainment industry. I mean, I could do impressions like Moira Rose from Schitt's Creek, but a position like that would not leave me properly habilimented. Or I could do Meemaw from Young Sheldon, but you know, there's that whole math, science, history, Big Bang thing, and, you know, we gotta move on. But you know what? I'd rather talk about math, because I love math. You will get all kinds of added benefits for your patronage. In addition to my infinite, infinite gratitude, depending on the tier, you also get, hold on to your seats, exclusive posts about math, science, history, and other stuff. Your name listed as a patron on my website, and early access to the podcast and the shows, and bonus math. Who wouldn't want bonus math? Also, I have giveaways now. So come on over to patreon.com/math science history. Sign up for a tier, become a patron, and be proud of the fact that you're actually being part of this project that promotes math and science from a whole new angle, learning about history. So thanks for tuning in. Until next time, carpe diem.